17th century India. The vast invading armies of the Mughals have swept through northern and central India, establishing their rulership over the local population. They have come to control an extremely vast and rich land. But this rapid expansion brought them in conflict with the already established southern kingdoms of Ahmednagar, Golconda, and Bijapur. Infighting was common between these states. In the northern region of the Bijapur kingdom, a young warrior prince, Shivaji Bhosle, inherits his father's domain, who was a general in the Bijapuri army. With some political maneuvering and impressive show of leadership, Shivaji has come to possess a number of forts and villages. This angers Adil Shah, the ruler of Bijapur and the former employer of Shivaji's father, Shahji Raje Bhosle. Adil Shah orders Afzal Khan, his most experienced general, to put an end to the growing threat posed by Shivaji. Afzal Khan, who was already at odds with Shivaji, prepares a 50,000 strong army and 12,000 support units. Afzal Khan, along with his 50,000 strong army, sets out from Bijapur to confront Shivaji. His army consisted of 20,000 cavalry, 15,000 infantry, 1,500 musketeers, 85 elephants, 1,200 camels, and 90 artillery cannon, which were all provided by the king of Bijapur. Also, he recruited his own 10,000 cavalry and 5,000 infantry. Along the way, he started pillaging many Hindu temples, most notably at Pandharpur and nearby areas. It had a threefold effect. It appeased his supporters, and the loot was enough to fund his campaign. Also, this would anger Shivaji, who was a devout Hindu, to leave his defensive mountainous positions for a quick battle in the plains nearby, where Afzal Khan's larger army was at a clear advantage. But Shivaji did not take this bait and set up camp at the newly constructed fort of Pratapgadh. This was a trap laid by Shivaji to draw out Afzal Khan towards Pratapgarh instead of moving into the Maratha heartland and raiding Pune, the Maratha capital, and the core territories of the Maratha kingdom. Maratha forces also started raiding Afzal Khan's supply lines after he turned towards Pratapgarh. With his supplies cut off and inside enemy territory, Afzal Khan was forced to either fight Shivaji at his own term or go back and negotiate peace with Shivaji. Afzal Khan, confident of his superior army, moved in on the fort of Pratapgarh, besieging it, hoping for a quick bloody battle. With all the pieces in place, the battle of the decade is about to begin. Maratha forces rushed to the defense of Pratapgarh fort and began preparing for the upcoming siege. They took up defensive positions in and out of the fort. Cleverly, some men were sent out into the nearby forest, hidden from the enemy's sight, waiting for a signal to strike on the enemy. Afzal Khan's forces began pouring into the valley. Their first order of business was to establish a battle line and gain a foothold near the fort. Secondly, to clear the nearby area for artillery encampments. All choke points in and out of the fort were cut off. With the arrival of Afzal Khan and the siege preparations completed, the cannons opened fire on the fort walls. But the newly constructed walls of Pratapgarh fort easily withstood the onslaught. Afzal Khan now understood that he had stepped into a trap and was not prepared for the defenses of Pratapgarh fort. And if he went back, he would lose prestige and further strengthen Shivaji's position. As his position weakened, he became more accepting of Shivaji's peace offers, which till now he had been thoroughly rejecting. Shivaji anticipated this in advance and sent his emissaries, who sang praises of Afzal Khan along with Shivaji's peace offers. With this flattering and the situation Afzal Khan found himself in, this was the best he could have hoped for. Afzal Khan agreed to meet Shivaji to discuss Shivaji's surrender. His advisors advised him not to take more than a few men along with him, just as Shivaji would, so as to not scare Shivaji away. This was a clever trick played by Shivaji to lure Afzal Khan into a false sense of an easy victory and to let his guard down, thinking Shivaji is weak and already subdued. Shivaji had set up a luxurious meeting tent beneath the footholds of Pratapgarh fort, and Afzal Khan proceeded there with only 10 of his most trusted men. Afzal Khan's men arrive ahead of him and immediately proceed to secure the compound. They search for Shivaji and his men, but do not find him anywhere there. A signal is given to Afzal Khan and he moves into the camp, but decides to wait outside the meeting tent, along with his two bodyguards and an advisor. He waits for Shivaji to arrive before going inside. With a sudden movement from the forest emerges Maratha men and present a formidable counterweight to Afzal Khan's men, and from the shadows appear Shivaji, dressed in plain clothes so as to not rouse suspicion. Shivaji presents himself to Afzal Khan and both men exchange greetings. Afzal Khan signals Shivaji to move inside the tent, but Shivaji objects to having armed bodyguards inside the tent, citing that they may try to kill him once inside. Afzal Khan orders his bodyguards to stand down and not approach them while inside. With this assurance, Shivaji agrees to proceed with the meeting. Afzal Khan moves inside the tent, dismissing his bodyguards' concerns, along with an advisor. He appreciates the arrangements made by Shivaji for him and to the extent Shivaji went through to arrange this meeting. His own bodyguard, Sayyid Banda, who was a renowned swordsman, stayed at guard. Shivaji waits a while outside and moves in only when Afzal Khan sends his approval. His personal bodyguard and friend Jiva Mahela also stays back, but within an earshot away. As he moves to the central part of the tent, Afzal Khan approaches him, but Shivaji cautiously stepped back, urging him to consider his surrender and to have mercy on him. Ever emboldened by this weakness shown by Shivaji, the 7 feet tall Afzal Khan grew more confident in his strength and urged Shivaji to embrace him in his arms and let the enmity between them be forgotten. As Shivaji embraced him, the treacherous 7 feet tall giant grabbed Shivaji by his neck and plunged a knife he had concealed within his clothes into Shivaji's back. But clever Shivaji had also worn a thin armor beneath his plain clothes on the advice of his advisors that Afzal Khan cannot be trusted. This advice saved Shivaji's life as the dagger slid away when it came in contact with his armor. At once, Shivaji took out his own hidden bhagnak and slashed Afzal Khan's stomach with it and tearing his intestines out. With great agony, Afzal Khan shouted for his bodyguard, who leapt in toward Shivaji's neck with a sword. But Shivaji's own bodyguard and personal friend Jiva slashed his hand with one clean blow. Taking advantage of this commotion, Afzal Khan managed to run outside and leapt into a palki, somehow still holding on to his torn and hanging intestines. His men were suddenly under attack from all sides as others tried to carry him away to safety. But one of Shivaji's horsemen, Sambhuji, gave chase and with great speed slashed Afzal Khan's head clean off from his body. This was a great victory for Shivaji and his men. Shivaji had sworn revenge on Afzal Khan for desecrating their ancestral Bhavani temple, mainly at Pandhapur, and other major Hindu sacred temples. He never intended to surrender, but to lure him into a one-on-one confrontation, this whole ruse was played by Shivaji. With Afzal Khan dead and his closest men slain, a signal was given to the fort of Pratapgarh from Shivaji to resume a tremendous barrage of cannon fire on the Bijapuri army, who were still unknown to the fate of their general. The surprise attack caught Adil Shahi army off guard, who were under the impression that their commander was negotiating Shivaji's surrender. The suddenness of this bombardment caused immense chaos amongst their rank as they haphazardly formed a defensive line. Maratha men began pouring out of the high fort's main gates and charged at the unprepared enemy. Their assault was so fierce that the Bijapuri left flank nearly collapsed. But as more fresh Bijapuri troops joined in, the momentum of the attack was stopped. Still, immense casualties were suffered by the leaderless Bijapuri left flank, and major portions of their troops were diverted just to hold back the Maratha warriors. Meanwhile, the cannon fire from Pratapgarh was also a signal for Shivaji's men hidden in the nearby forest to begin their own assault on the unsuspecting Bijapuri forces. Maratha units hidden inside the forests managed to sneak behind the enemy lines and charged the rear guard, routing the Bijapuri artillery one after the other on both flanks. Some of Shivaji's elite warriors engaged the enemy head-on and a fierce battle ensued. Bijapuri army, now engaged on all fronts and suffering heavy casualties, could not reinforce their left flank anymore. The now unchallenged units turned around and with a great momentum crashed into the rear of the already demoralized and tired Bijapuri forces. This completely shattered the Bijapuri resolve to fight, and their forces began routing in mass from the battlefield. Maratha forces gave no ground and pursued the deserters and cut down any in their way. Hundreds of men died that day, and those who surrendered and pleaded mercy were captured. The entire Adil Shahi army was completely and utterly decimated, with 5,000 killed and another 5,000 seriously wounded. More than 3,000 men had surrendered, with their entire artillery destroyed or captured, more than 60 war elephants, 4,000 horses, and 1,200 camels were lost. Also, the Marathas captured huge amounts of jewels worth more than 300,000 rupees and gold worth more than 1 million rupees, along with other valuables and other supplies. Help us fund this project. We need your support. Thank you for watching.